Pray. We could never thank God enough for Amen. His sacrifice, for his love. Amen. He loved us first before we even loved him. Amen. Amen. I thank God for that. And welcome. Excuse me. Welcome, welcome, welcome this morning. Yes, it's so good to see all the ladies in their fine hats. And I'm just grateful for God's presence. That's what counts here at Mount Moriah Community Church. I'm going to have our Pastor John open us up this morning. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you, Sister Jackie, once again for inviting everyone into Mount Moriah through the playing of songs. And took a while because those hats were interfering with the signal.
I think so.
But we thank God for breaking through.
Amen. Amen. And I think Sister D, her hat was the antenna for us today.
Her hat was the antenna that brought it back. Yes, indeed.
Oh my.
That's all right. You ladies look lovely. I don't, understand quite, because I'm not a woman, all of the stuff that women put in their head, their hair. I mean, but I guess there's a reason behind it. I mean, but anyway, we thank God for you ladies and for taking this opportunity to celebrate Hat Day. What can I say? And with that, we want to once again thank you for coming to another Mount Moriah Community Church service, virtual service brought to you by Zoom. God, as I always say, has a word for you today. Don't leave your sofa without it.
Hey.
Thank God that he continues to bless our souls with his word and with this ministry. So without further ado, remember, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Habakkuk 2:20.
Thank you, Pastor John. And if you are unmuted, please mute yourself if you can. Sister Hazel, you're an exception. All right, so if you could just stay as quiet as possible. Amen, amen. One second, let me just make sure. I'm getting a lot of interference here, so let me just kind of, dang, I see you shaking your head, Sister Carol. Just making sure everyone that's muted needs to be muted. Amen. Ooh, I'm going to have to mute somebody. I'm going to have to mute just Sister Hazel.
Okay.
I'm getting a lot of static. Sorry about that. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Amen.
Lord, from sorrows deep I call, when my hope is shaken, torn and ruined from the fall, hear my desperation, for so long I've pled and prayed, God, come to my rescue. Even so, the thorn remains, still my heart will praise you. Storms within my troubled soul, questions without answers, on my faith these pillows roll. Down my soul, hope in him who saves you. When the fires have all grown cold, cause this heart to praise you. Should my life be torn from me? Every worldly pleasure, when all I possess is grief, God be then my treasure, be my vision in the night, be my hope and refuge, till my face is turned aside, Lord, my heart will praise you.
I trust in God. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for listening. Amen. We're going to have just a few announcements. And while I have everyone on screen here, we just want to just give a round of applause to our lovely ladies here wearing their hats. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Looking good. Everybody's looking good. Something about a hat. I'm not a hat person, but something about a hat, I tell you, it just makes you feel a little extra special. Amen. And thank you for being obedient, if you could. I'm not faulting anyone who wasn't able to, but thank you for your obedience there, wearing your hats. God bless you. Amen. Excuse me, while my computer is a little lagging there, a little running a little slow there. Amen, amen. I think I've welcomed everyone here, and I'm sure God's presence has too. Again, as it was said, this is our Mount Moriah Community Church virtual service, and I do so far hope that you are enjoying yourself with the fellowship here. Amen. The seven last sayings of Christ will be held on Good Friday, April 7th at 7 p.m. That is going to be virtual. Amen. And we ask that you all come and join us in remembering his sacrifice. That's Good Friday, April 7th at 7 p.m. The last seven sayings of Christ. Amen. Amen. And again, all the latest and greatest upcoming events, services, and resources can be found on our website, and that's www.mountmoriahcc.com. And March is Women's History Month. Amen. And we are going to have our Health Matters at Mount Moriah Community Church with our Sister Wendy Cadle this morning. Amen. And Sister Wendy, the hour is in your hands. I wouldn't say hour, but it's in your hands at this time. Uh-huh. Amen. Unmute yourself.
Okay. Am I unmuted?
Yes, you are.
Okay. Good morning, Mount Moriah. With it being Women's History Month, I'm going to honor women with speaking about the most common issues in women's health. Okay. The number one issue is breast cancer, and it's the most common cancer in women. Number two is heart disease. And in the US, one woman in 16 at over the age of 20, they have some kind of coronary heart disease. I think that's an amazing number. You wouldn't think that it was so prevalent, but it is. Ovarian and cervical cancer, gynecological cancers are also common women health concerns. We have pregnancy issues, depression and anxiety, obesity and weight issues, migraine headaches, and I've added one to the list, osteoporosis. But I like to ask you today, do you all know the top two causes of death of women in the United States? Well, the number one cause is cardiac heart disease. And the main issue with heart disease is that women in some of the most common early signs of heart disease, they are often overlooked, a mistake, misdiagnosed for something else. But I like to make you aware of these symptoms and caution you not to take them for granted. Okay, number one is chest pains, often described as tightness, pressure, squeezing, or aching under the chest, under the breast bone. Don't assume that you're experiencing this due to stress. Number two is shortness of the breath, with or without exertion. Don't assume you're just out of shape. Number three, extreme or unusual fatigue. Don't assume you are just busy with work and life's demands. Number four, discomfort in the arms, the legs, the back, the neck, the jaw, or the stomach. Don't assume that you worked out too much or caught a bug. These symptoms can occur when the heart isn't getting enough oxygen. And number five, symptoms often come and go, but don't assume that because they come and go that they aren't important. There are some other symptoms also, which in some cases may be quite prominent, but you still wouldn't associate it with heart disease. Such things as nausea, vomiting, indigestion, cold sweats, lightheadedness, sleep disturbances, shortness of breath, anxiety. Now, I like to switch from signs and symptoms quickly to a cause that you might not associate with heart disease either, and that's gum disease. Having gum disease increases the risk of developing heart disease also. Poor dental health increases the risk of bacterial infections in the bloodstream, which can affect the heart valves. Oral health may be particularly important for people that have artificial heart valves. So good dental health is a combination of course, the proper daily practices of flossing and brushing and flossing, along with regular visits to your dental health professional. And even people that wear dentures, they should visit the dentist at least twice a year. So the doctor can check the fit, he can make any adjustments if necessary, and check the gum health, because dentures harbor germs leading back to gum disease. So see that dentist. Okay, the second leading cause of death in women in the United States is cancer. And the most common cancer, again, among women is breast cancer. But research shows that you can reduce your chance of getting cancer by a few simple lifestyle changes, like maintaining a healthy weight, eating a balanced diet, avoiding or limiting alcohol, breastfeeding if you can, and avoiding hormone therapy after menopause. Screening is just as important. So women should do a self-exam monthly, the same time every month. And this practice can be very important because it's a way of finding breast cancer early. I want to stress that because I just want to throw this in here. There are different kinds of breast cancer, ladies. So I just want to just put that in there. Mammograms are pertinent also. Women between 40 and 44, they have the option of starting a yearly mammogram. Women 45 to 54, they should get a mammogram yearly. And then women that are 55 and older, they can switch from either having one every other year or still opt for the yearly one. You would make that decision with your doctor, of course. So remember, screening means early detection, which means a better clinical outcome. Now, in closing, I want to say that we are blessed to live in a time where there is modern medicine, and nothing so wonderful could exist without God. He gave man the knowledge, and he has given us access to this knowledge. So pay attention to your bodies and see your doctor if you feel something is wrong. You know, we as women, we take care of others. And then we as Christians, we wait on God, on the right hand of God. However, God has placed people with knowledge like doctors, nurses, scientists, with cutting edge equipment and procedures in our past for us to take advantage of. So please do, ladies and gentlemen, because modern medicine is truly a blessing from God. In closing, I like to read Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 8 from the Message Bible. My sister told me to make sure I let you know that it's where I was reading it from. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do. Everywhere you go, he's the one who will keep you on track. Don't assume that you know it all. Run to God, run from evil. Your body will glow with health. Your very bones will vibrate with health. Amen. Thank you for having me today.
Amen. God bless. Amen. Thank you, Sister Wendy. And that's Health Matters at Mount Moriah with our Sister Wendy Cadle. Thank you so much for your research and your knowledge. God bless you. Amen. And thank you everyone again, as she said, for listening. Right now, we're going to go into our scripture reading. Amen. And that is by our Elder Roy Stewart. Good morning, Elder Stewart.
Well, good morning, Sister Jackie, and good morning, Mount Moriah. Happy readings to you this morning from the Living Bible. The book of Mark, chapter 3, verses 28 through 35. I solemnly declare that any sin of man can be forgiven, even blasphemy against me. But blasphemy against the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven. It is an eternal sin. He told them this because they were saying he did his miracles by Satan's power instead of acknowledging it was by the Holy Spirit's power. Now his mother and brothers arrived at the crowded house when he was teaching, and they sent word for him to come out and talk with them. Your mother and brothers are outside and want to see you, he was told. He replied, who is my mother? Who are my brothers? Looking at those around him, he said, these are my mother and brothers. Anyone who does God's will is my brother and my sister and my mother. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Elder Roy, for reading God's word this morning. Right now, we're going to have our Elder Rhonda Sheckett for the morning prayer.
Good morning, First Lady Shekin, and giving honor to the Most High God, giving honor to Mount Moriah, to all our Zoom members. Oh, Father God, in Jesus' name, we give you honor, praise, and glory. Oh, Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Thank you, oh Jesus, for loving us so much. You are obedient to the leading of the Father's will in our behalf. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for salvation. Everything else stems from salvation. Thank you for loving us so much to forgive us. Thank you, Father God, for our prayer list, for every need. It's an opportunity to glorify you. Oh, Father God, as we lift not we ourselves and our family and friends and neighbors and co-workers up, but all these on the prayer list. Yes, oh, we thank you for this opportunity to serve you, to pour out our heart to you, because you are a prayer answering God. Yes, oh, are. And every prayer gets heard and every prayer gets answered.
Thank you, Jesus.
Nevertheless, not necessarily in our time, but in your time, you answer every single need. Oh, Father God, continue to bless us through the further course of this day, that you get the glory. Pour out your spirit upon Elder Mel, oh, Father God. Oh, Father God, minister the word to all of us today. Touch our hearing, touch our heart to receive your word through our Elder Mel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love the words to this song, and it just speaks a whole lot to where we are as a people right now.
Amen.
You know, the devil fought Whitney all the way to the end. He even fought her today, trying not to allow her song to play. But the words to her song says, "I love the Lord. He heard my cry. And as long as I live, and as troubles rise, I will hasten to his throne.
Amen.
I will run because I can go to his throne."
Amen.
Amen. Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Our message this morning is, we are family. So if you don't have your Bible, your sword, your weapon, you may want to grab it just in case something jumps off this morning with the enemy. You'll be ready.
Amen.
You all don't know this, but this month is actually my 1 year anniversary of being a part of Mount Moriah. Yep, it's been a year already. And this month, in the month of March, I tuned into my first Zoom service at Mount Moriah. And I was thinking back to what my first Zoom service was like. And well, as you can imagine, First Lady did a masterful job mixing the music for praise and worship. And then Pastor John opened the service by saying, "The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him." Habakkuk 2:20. And when he said it, it caught my attention, because what's interesting about the prophet Habakkuk was that the prophets in the Bible were God's mouthpiece, but Habakkuk was bold enough to question God before he delivered God's prophetic words to the people. He questioned God because he was concerned about the present condition in Judah and the evil that God had allowed to exist. He couldn't understand how God could just stand by and allow so much evil to be all around the righteous and so much power and success to be given to the wicked. And I'm sure we've probably had some of these same questions ourselves, considering the times that we live in now. But, you know, God listened to Habakkuk and he heard his questions and he answered him. And God affirmed to Habakkuk that he is still on the throne of the universe and that Habakkuk and us need to stay focused on that. So I'm thinking to myself, the pastor opens the service with the command from Habakkuk saying, the Lord is in his holy temple, let the earth be silent before him.
Amen.
So in other words, be quiet in God's presence and listen to what the Lord is saying to you. A direct command with huge spiritual but personal significance. And I'm saying, okay. Then Elder Gill spoke that Sunday about the three main spiritual weapons we can use to fight off the enemy, which are God's word, our praise, our prayers. And these three weapons, when used effectively, confuses the enemy. And while I'm listening to the message, I'm looking and seeing the faces, counting the number of people I know and how many I may be related to. And I'm saying, you know what? We're all family. We're all family in this service. And some of us might remember back in the 80s, a group of girls called Sister Sledge. They had a number one song on the American Billboard charts called We Are Family. And I've got all my sisters with me.
Yeah.
And in an interview back then, they said the song represented community and kinship for everyone, regardless of how they may be judged. And apparently millions of people identified with the song for it to be number one on the charts. However, in the book of Mark, we gain a different perspective of family. Now, we know Elder Roy, with his smooth voice, has already read the scriptures for us, but we're going to take another look at it. And it reads, I solemnly declare that any sin of man can be forgiven. Now, this is from the book of Mark, chapter 3. Verses 28 through 35. I solemnly declare that any sin of man can be forgiven, even blasphemy against me. But blasphemy against the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven. It's an eternal sin. I don't know if you all remember, but back in the day, you know, sometimes we may, you know, get in a disagreement, might get in a fight with somebody. And we'll say, okay, now you can talk about me, but if you talk about my mama, now those are fighting words. So Jesus is saying right here, right now, I see y'all out there. Y'all can talk about me, but don't talk about the Holy Spirit. Let's look at verse 30. He told them this because they were saying he did his miracles by Satan's power instead of acknowledging it was by the Holy Spirit's power. Now, his mother and brother arrived at the crowded house where he's teaching, and they sent word for him to come out and talk with them. Now, to understand this verse, you have to kind of understand what's going on in chapter 3. A lot's going on in Mark chapter 3 because in chapter 3, this is where Jesus heals the man with the shriveled hand on a Sunday, on a Sabbath. So, you know, all the Pharisees were saying, look, he's healing on the Sabbath. That's against the law. So now we've got something that we can use against him to persecute him. Then he begins to teach in the crowd. As he's teaching in the crowd, the Pharisees come to him again, you know, just poking at him. Then he decides to appoint his 12 apostles. All of this is happening in chapter 3. he appoints his 12 apostles. Then as you read down further, Jesus is accused by his family and by the teachers of law that what he's doing, he should not be doing. So here we see where Jesus is trying to start his ministry, do the work of the Lord, and he's got his family who don't understand. He's got people in the crowd who is interested in what he's saying, but now you've got these Pharisees who's pointing fingers at him. So now in verse 31, it says, now his mother and his brother, they arrive at the crowded house where he's teaching, and they sent word for him, come out, we want to talk with you. And someone says, hey Jesus, your mom is outside, your brothers, they outside, they won't have a word with you. So Jesus is starting to get a little frustrated with this. And he's saying, let's look at verse 33. He replies and say, who is my mother? Who are my brothers? Looking at those around him, he said, these are my mother and brothers. Anyone who does God's will is my brother and my sister and my mother, period. End of discussion. So sit down and listen and see what the Spirit of God, what the Spirit of God is saying and speaking. So you see, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God said, I am your Lord and I change not. And throughout the scriptures, the Bible referred to us as children of God, joint heirs. And we've got a heavenly Father. He called us his people who are called by his name. And why does God refer to us as people who are called by his name? Because Satan has people too, and who are called by his name. But if we look back at verse 11 in Mark, verse 11, you'll see where wherever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, you are the Son of God. You see, the devil is in the crowd too. And his knee will have to bow just like everybody else's.
No.
But the interesting thing is in verse 12, but he gave them strict orders not to tell others about him. And guess what? They have to obey. Amen. So now, as we move forward into the meat of where we're going with the scriptures and where we're going with the message, in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, this is where God speaks to Solomon as he's dedicating the temple that he took 7 years to build. So let's turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And we may need to take the interstate to get to Chronicles. It's a pretty good distance from where we are in Mark. So if you're going to take the interstate, you can take the back road, but you may take a little while to get there. But if you take the interstate, you're going to drive past Genesis all the way, down past Exodus. You're going to come on down to Deuteronomy. You're going to pass Joshua and Judges, Ruth, Samuel, come on past all of those. First King, Second King. Slow down now when you get to Second Kings, because now you're going to find First Chronicles. And when you find First Chronicles, Second Chronicle lives right next door. Amen.
Amen.
When you find to say amen, I'll give God a wave. So we got it. Amen. So Second Chronicles.
Amen.
Amen. Second Chronicles, as we examine verses 1 through 16. Now, I'll be using the English Standard Version, but the Bible is clear on what's happening in this place. Second Chronicles, chapter 7. Solomon had 7 years of building the temple in Jerusalem. And now he's ready to dedicate the temple to God. and all of Israel is there to celebrate the dedication. It's about 2 million people at this time. And a picture is worth a thousand words. And you can see that the atmosphere shifts in the presence of God. Everything around us changes in the presence of God. And when God shows up in the temple, you know, we won't be able to handle the presence of God when he shows up. Even the priests had to be careful. But let's look at verse 1 in chapter 7. As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not even enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the house. And when all the people of Israel, saw the fire come down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed down on their faces to the ground and worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." But God already knew that all the people of Israel was not his people. But he wanted all of them to be. But as the atmosphere changes in the presence of God, everything all around changes in the presence of God. Now we see in verse 4 through 11, where Solomon dedicates the temple and he dedicates the house of God. And in verse 4, it says, "Then the king of all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. King Solomon offered a sacrifice of 22,000 oxen, 120,000 sheep. I guess that'd be enough to feed 2 million people. So the king and all the people dedicated the house of God. The priests stood at the post, the Levites, also with the instruments of music to the law that King David had made, for giving thanks to the Lord for his steadfast love endures forever. Whenever David offered praise by their ministry, opposite them, the priests sounded trumpets. And all Israel stood." Now we come to verse 12 through 16, where God speaks to Solomon. "Then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, 'I have heard your prayer, and I have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice.'" But verse 13, "But it's just a matter of time now before I shut up the heavens so that there's no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among the people." So now God says this: "This is what I need. I've heard your prayers for Israel, and I will answer your prayers under these three conditions. First, my people, my family, those who know me as their Heavenly Father, need to be humble. Second, they need to pray and seek me willingly. And third, they must repent and turn their hearts back to me. Now, when this is done, here's what I will do." And let's look at verse 14 through 16. He says to Solomon, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be here forever. My ears and my heart will be there for all times." So you see, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus began his ministry with the crowd. His message was, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And salvation is the way to the eternal, everlasting family. So, you know, the same message that God gave Solomon, the three conditions that he gave his people, Jesus and Mark was given the same conditions. Who is my family? Those who will do the will of the Lord. These are my family. This is my people who are called by my name. And if you would just sort of bear with me, I want to be sensitive to the Spirit of God as he leads and guides this morning. You know, I look back over my first Zoom service and I look at where I see us, where we have come from a year ago in March to now. And I see where every Sunday morning, there's approximately 25 to 35 of us across the country and across the world when we zoom in from Africa. And we witness God demonstrating that he is omnipresent. You know, we can praise and worship God together from right where we are. And if you've been praying and fasting and or believing and waiting for answers and waiting for a sign or a word from God, you can lay hands on yourself and go before the throne of grace and take your needs to the altar before God right now. And if we can touch and agree, let's go before the Lord as one church family and release our prayers in the heavenlies. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And Father God, we come to the throne of grace as your people who are called by your name. We come, Lord, because we trust in you. We need you, Father God. We pray, Lord, that your eyes are open and your ears are attentive to our prayers this morning. We know that in your presence is the fullness of joy, and we come this morning looking for a breakthrough and believing this is our season to reap what we've sown, Father God. We come, Lord, looking for yokes to be destroyed. We come believing you for a miracle and a blessing, Lord God. Just allow your Holy Spirit and anointing to fall fresh on us right now. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Lord, just hear our prayers, Father God. Yes, Lord. Hear us, Lord, as we speak to the enemy and cancel every assignment he may have against us, yes, Father Lord. God. Hear us, Lord, as we speak to sickness and pain, yes, in our bodies to be healed in the name of Jesus. Lord, we speak to weak knees. We speak to damaged kidneys, yes, and every organ in our body to line up right now according to your word, Father God. Just take the joint pains away, Lord God. Heal every broken heart and give us a clear mind of who we are and who you've created us to be, Father God. Mend our broken relationships with our family, with our children, with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord God, Lord, just open up the windows of heaven and pour out your blessing upon us, Lord God. Let everything work together for our good this morning, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your grace. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the release of your Spirit and the anointing upon us, Lord. We receive the blessings right now, Lord, that you've already released in every room and every household that are tuned into you this morning, Lord. And Lord, we just thank you, Father God. We praise you. We give you the glory. We give you the honor.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Yes, Lord.
And we all say amen, 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 and amen.
Amen.
I just want to say hallelujah and thank you, Father God, for allowing us to continue to be in your family. We thank you, Lord, for Mount Moriah. We thank you for the word that you've continued to bring forth to us, Lord God, as a church family. Lord, we know that you've continued to bless us, and we thank you. We receive it right now in Jesus' name. These prayers we ask once again, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. And Elder Roy, I'll pass the mantle to you, sir.
Thank you there, Elder Mel. And we thank you for your message today on we are family. And I like to re-echo that same sentiment, and that is we are family.
Amen.
And Lord, we thank you that you've found a way to make us all join together as family. In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
And now we offer up our benediction for today. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for another Sunday, another Sabbath, another day of worship, Lord, that you provided, that we've come together. And Lord, we thank you for the day that of Hat Day for the women of the church.
Amen.
Taking the time, Lord, to sport their headwear in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, as we prepare our hearts and our minds, Lord, to leave this service and to enter into a new week this week, a new work week for some, and just another week, Lord, time goes on. We just pray, Lord, that you would be with us, that you would continue, Lord, to watch over and keep us. Keep us safe, Lord, and protect us. In the blessed name of Jesus, we pray. Not just us alone, but our households.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Thank you, Jesus.
For your glory, Lord.
Your glory.
And amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.